Namaste. This is Dr. Ramya Krishnan. I am working as Associate Professor and Head of the Department of Applied Pharmacology in Rajiv Gandhi Ayurveda Medical College, Mahi. Today I have come on to this video because yesterday I happened to participate in a club meet, which the link was sent by a few of my friends, and the meeting discussion was regarding pseudo-scientificity of Ayurveda and homeopathy. So I was not there in the beginning. I just participated on for I think 20 to 30 minutes. And what I understood is that it is organized by an organization called Essence Global or something like that. And also many people were attending the program, among which Ayurveda doctors and modern medicine practitioners were also there. And the people who were talking authentically in support of this were heard much from Western medicine practitioners. I have heard them talking about the pseudo-scientificity, like the experiences which they had from Ayurveda people who underwent Ayurveda treatments. And they were in support of this organization in the matter of pseudo-scientificity of Ayurveda. And one or two times I tried to speak by raising my hands, but I was not accepted by the moderators. So I thought, as the program is attended by many people, I thought it's my duty and responsibility, being a scientific practitioner of Ayurveda, to clarify before the audience the truth regarding the scientificity of Ayurveda. For this reason I have come. So the interesting thing was that the people who were talking much about the pseudo-scientificity of Ayurveda, first of all, they were not knowing anything other than the spelling of Ayurveda. I didn't find any authentic people who are qualified in the field of Ayurveda who are talking about the, who are explaining or rationalizing the pseudo-scientificity of Ayurveda. All the people who were talking were not qualified in Ayurveda. They were not Ayurveda professionals. They were guessing, assuming something and telling too many things. Like this, I felt that if there is a discussion happening, there should be both the sides. There should be authentic people from Ayurveda and homeopathy as well, who will be substantiating the opposition side, but which was not happening there. So I thought, being a scientific Ayurveda practitioner, I am here to clarify the things. So first of all, what is a medical science? A medical science comprises of two aspects, medicine and science. So actually, medical science is intended to heal the patient. First of all, this is my point. A medical science is intended to heal the patient. So there are two aspects. Let us consider science. What is science? We are learning science from school. We know that what is science? Science is a set of logics or rational which explain the cause, mechanism, effect relationship of every phenomena. Let it be physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics. Everything is science. Why? Because we are learning certain phenomena of universe or living things. And we are understanding the relationship between cause, mechanism and effect. So this is what we are learning in science theory classes. And when we move to practicals, what we have learned, the theories, theorems, laws, principles and logics, we are experimenting in the labs. We are testing and verifying the logics. We are observing what is happening, whether by this cause, this mechanism and this results are happening, or whether results are different. If the results are different, how it became different? Whether it was the logic applied which is wrong, or whether the procedure which was wrong? What was the problem? Where was the problem? So such things are being verified in the labs. And finally, with the lab study, we are confirming or we are establishing any particular theory or theorem or laws or principles which we have learned in science. So science exactly is derived from the word scientia, which means knowledge. So nowadays there is a confusion in the very terminology of science, which I think is created by Western medicine itself, that science means doing experiment or doing research. Actually, research is meant to acquire knowledge in science. Research as such is not science. Research is a method which is developed, which is to be done to explore any natural phenomenon. So in order to explore a phenomenon, to understand the cause, mechanism, effect, relationship as much as possible and to document it in a systematic way. And once it is documented, the knowledge which we attain is called as science. So there are two types of research, basic and applied research. Basic research is to understand the mechanisms. Why, how, what, when, where, how not, why not. All these things, basic mechanisms are known by basic research. And applied research means what all knowledge we have acquired from the basic research. Again, it is the knowledge which we acquire. Again, it is the knowledge itself, which we acquire from the basic research, is applied in different conditions. And we are evaluating the results. So that is what is called applied research. So science as such is not research. Science is the knowledge background for research. And science explains how to conduct research. Before conducting a research, what kind of knowledge you should be having and which method is to be adopted in research, why and how to conduct research, the protocol of the research, and how to analyze the results of the research. All these are explained by science originally. So medicine, now coming to medicine. Medicine means what? Generally, medicine is something that heals. So medicine, even though Western medicine or modern medicine calls medicine, actually it is their drug, not medicine. And they have defined drug that it is something which is meant to modify the physiological response, physiological or pathological changes in the body in favor of the person to acquire benefits. So a drug is a substance. It can be derived from a plant or an animal or a chemical, whatever it is something which is intended to modify the physiological or pathological changes in the body in order to acquire more benefits in the subject. So there is a significant difference between benefits and healing. So this point, actually it is not known to the layman, public. That's why I am explaining all this. Benefits do not mean healing. Benefits means some advantages. Benefits are always accompanied by risk. Whenever you try to produce some benefits forcibly or artificially, like a drug will do benefits. A drug will try to produce benefits. In modern medicine, I mean, a drug is intended to produce benefits by blocking, masking, altering, suppressing, etc. Okay. Of enzymes, ion channels, neuromediators and different receptors in the body. They will be artificially stimulating or suppressing or blocking, etc. These are the mechanisms of actions of drugs. Nowhere it is mentioned that drug is something which is intended to reverse the disease and produce health. It is nowhere there in modern medicine. It cannot do that except for surgical interventions or certain other interventions. Drugs as such are intended to mask, block, suppress, alter, mimic, etc. So this is the difference between drug and medicine. At the same time, they call it as modern medicine. They don't call it as modern drug. Actually, medicine in Ayurveda is defined. The technical term for medicine is Bheshaja. Bheshaja means Tadhaiva Yuktam Bheshajyam Yadarogyaya Kalpade. Bheshaja is that which is intended to produce health in the human being. So there is no question of benefits and risk there. In Ayurveda, it is not mentioned like Benefitaya Kalpade. It is mentioned as Arogyaya Kalpade. So the responsibility of the physician or the scientific practitioner of Ayurveda is much higher than that of conventional medicine, because physician is not intended to produce benefits and risk in Ayurveda. He is intended to produce only health. Health means reversal of disease and natural consequence of health in the body. This is the objective of Ayurveda and modern medicine. So modern medicine, actually medical science. So why they are calling medical science? Modern medicine, why they are calling medical science? They consider modern medicine is considered to be scientific medicine. And nobody is questioning them why and how you are scientific medicine. This concept of scientific medicine was introduced by Dr. Gordon Gyatt in 1990, after about 10 years after evidence-based medicine emerged. By David Sackett, in 1981 it emerged, evidence-based medicine. So till the emergence of evidence-based medicine, till 1981, doctors in modern medicine were practicing based on experiences, self or shared experiences, dogma, or expert opinions, etc. Like that they were practicing. So in 1981, David Sackett told, this is not a proper way. He's an epidemiologist. So he thought himself that it is not a scientific way, because my experience may be correct or may not be correct. There could have been much better experience. So it is not a good way. So what he thought is that by conducting epidemiological studies, by practicing data-oriented medicine, every time it should be remembered that in modern medicine, research begins with an unknown compound. Every time research begins with an unknown compound, let it be plant or animal or synthetic, chemical, whatever it is, it begins with an unknown compound. So this unknown compound, to call it as a medicine, to transform it as a medicine, there should be some evidences or proofs to substantiate the particular action and safety of the drug. So for that unknown compound, there should be some proof of effectiveness or efficacy, mode of action, that it works on this receptor and this is safe. To achieve that objective, there should be some evidence. So this evidence, how can we achieve an evidence in the case of an unknown compound? It's very difficult. No, only by giving the compound we can do. So they have started new drug development in different phases of research. So the first phase, they will study the toxicity of this drug. Okay, so first they will study in the isolated tissues or animals. Then once it is below the approved level of toxicity, if it is in the safe margin, then it will be trialed in the next human volunteers. So human volunteers, group of population, one group will be given this drug, another group will be given standard drug or even placebo, and they are comparing which one is better in benefits and which one is lesser in risk. So this is how they are doing research in the second phase. So first phase, toxicity study in animals. After that, they are directly introducing volunteers and they are evaluating whether benefits are outweighing risk in that particular population in that particular period of time. So this is what is called evidence-based medicine. So after what they get, and it is done in a population. Okay, so out of, for example, 10,000 people, 2,000 people got risk and 8,000 people got survived with benefits. The drug may be approved as more benefits and less risk. We don't know, but it is a specific population of 10,000 people. If it is studied again in larger populations or variable populations, results may vary. So there is no certainty for these benefits also. Whatever is established as benefits also, benefits and risks are interchangeable anytime. But what they think is that as they are starting with unknown compounds, and as they are having no way, absolutely no way to confirm or to ethically consider it as treatment, a device for treatment or an object for treatment, they want some evidence to prove that this drug is having this benefits outweighing risk, and it is also this kind of effects, benefits are observed in the population, and it is also safe. So in order to prove that, they are practicing evidence-based medicine. So doctors will be, more and more doctors are asked to search Google search engines. There are variable search engines for them. They will be referring data of benefits and risks, and they will be administering compounds based on this evidence. So in my opinion, it is not evidence-based drug. It is actually drug-based evidence, which they consider as evidence-based medicine. This is the truth. But in Ayurveda, it is not like that. First of all, let me clarify, Ayurveda is not drug or medicine oriented science. It is science oriented medicine. This is the first thing I would like to clarify. In order to call a medical science a science, in order to call a medical science a science, there should be a science which approves the use of a particular medicine in a particular situation. Then only we can call a medical science a science. Otherwise, it becomes just medicine only. No science is there. Science means there should be definite logics within that body of knowledge, within that body of knowledge to substantiate why and how this particular medicine itself is used in this particular condition, or even no medicine is used in that particular condition to reverse the disease. Some other non-medicinal method is used to reverse the disease. So what logic the physician has adopted from the science to be applied in this particular patient in his particular unique cause circumstances to reverse the disease condition. That logic oriented medicine is being recommended to be selected in Ayurveda. So in Ayurveda, it is a complete science of man. So already Ayurveda, don't think that some people will ask me like Ayurveda is developed by just some people were walking by the road. They found some herb. When they were having fever, they ate that herb and their temperature went down. Then they decided that that is fever medicine. Absolutely rubbish knowledge is spread all over in society regarding Ayurveda. It's not like that. Ayurveda is not an open therapeutic formulary. Ayurveda is a science which has done extensive basic and applied research in all the diseases. Okay, even fever, which is considered as a disease, not a symptom in Ayurveda, discuss all the possible types of cause mechanisms or etiopathogenesis which can cause infective and non-infective fever in human beings. All the variable cause mechanisms. So with that logics, it is possible to diagnose and reverse even the future fevers, not the present COVID-19, newly emerging infective fevers also. We can adopt the same logics. Logics are available to us. Tools are available to us in the science of Ayurveda. And these logics are completely oriented on human being, internal circumstances of human being, cause circumstances, and not based on pathogens. So we don't have any worry regarding external pathogens. Ayurveda cares about host immune response to pathogens. So we are having such an extensive science which discuss what to do, how to understand a patient in his unique cause circumstances, how to understand the nature of a disease in general, what kind of logics are to be incorporated here to reverse the cause mechanisms of this particular disease, and what kind of medicine, whether any medicine is required to reverse or non-medicational guidelines are to be adopted here. If at all any medicine is required, which medicine will be apt here, why and how, which other medicines are not applicable, why and how. So all these aspects, medicines which are explained in Ayurveda are not unknown compounds. Medicines which are explained in the science of Ayurveda, Charaka Samhita, Ashtanga Hridaya, Ashtanga Samhita, Ashtanga Sangraha, Sushruta Samhita, all these grandhas, these are our authentic medical textbooks, basic medical textbooks. So these textbooks, what they explain are very vast diagnostic and treatment principles to explore, ponder into all the old and new diseases in Ayurveda. In fact, old diseases and newly emerging diseases, which are also having tools like, for example, essential primary hypertension. Our science has definite tools to explore essential primary hypertension, for which the cause is unknown in modern medicine. So every individual BP can vary by different reasons. Sometimes it could be dehydration. Sometimes it could be inflammation. Sometimes it could be hormonal. Sometimes it could be even starving, not taking any food. So that can also cause BP. Sometimes it can be by exertion. So once we are able to explore by Ayurvedic principles, we will be able to understand easily by what reason this particular patient BP is raised, and we can evaluate, we can apply the treatment principle to reverse the condition. In dehydration, we don't need to give any medicine. We can implement the right scientific medicated water and we can reverse the condition within hours, within minutes, we can reverse the condition. So what I am telling is that such pinpointed principles or logics, this is what is called science. And this science is what is making Ayurveda a medical science. I repeat, this science, this background science of logics, of diagnosis, differential diagnosis, prognosis and treatment, what is explained in Ayurveda, is making our science a medical science. Whereas in modern medicine, their sciences are anatomy, physiology, pathology, pharmacology, etc. But biotechnology also for developing drugs. But while coming to clinical practice, modern medicine doctors are not supposed to explore these pathophysiological rationale alone. They are forced to practice evidence-based medicine. And what is this evidence-based medicine? Evidence-based medicine begins with unknown compound. And what is this unknown compound doing? Suppressing, blocking, masking, altering, mimicking, etc. Whatever drugs it is, whatever drugs they are choosing, they have drugs only for these mechanisms. If you refer and any of the pharmacology textbook or Google, you will understand mechanisms of action of modern medicine, either by blocking, suppressing, altering, mimicking, supplementing, etc. So this is what they consider as evidence-based medicine. And their evidence is completely based on data. So in Ayurveda, there are two kinds of evidences, primary and secondary evidence. Primary evidence is for the physician. Primary evidence is based on science. Primary evidence is oriented on logics in science. That an outsider cannot understand what is our primary evidence. A person who should strive hard to understand the Ayurvedic approach of scientificity will only understand what is primary evidence. For example, in a person with acute fever, our primary evidence why we are choosing one particular medicine or medicated water is entirely dependent on the host immune mechanisms which are explored and explained in scientific terminologies and explanations in our text. For an outsider, it is absolute nonsense, because this is like telling if I don't know something, I will call it nonsense means what? For an outsider of Ayurveda who doesn't know anything about ABCD, when I tell him what is the samprapti of jwara here, what is the cause mechanism of infective fever, what is the cause mechanism of COVID-19, when I explain to him in Sanskrit terms, as I have learned biology, modern biology in 8th, 9th and 10th, I am learning modern medicine, all the subjects in our curriculum, except biochemistry, everything we are learning in our curriculum in the same stretch. I can understand what host immune mechanisms are explained in modern medicine, and also modern physiology, and also I can understand the mode of action of pharmacology. What is paracetamol doing? What is aspirin doing? What is antibiotic doing? What is antiviral drugs doing? All this I can know. But that is not the case of Ayurvedic pharmacology, Ayurvedic pathophysiology, Ayurvedic physiology, Ayurvedic anatomy, everything. It is explained in a different language. It is explained in a different language and it is explained in detail. Subtle most mechanisms. It's a highly complicated and highly vast science. It's not like when modern medicine considers cell as the fundamental unit, we have sub-fundamental units for cell inside. So this is how we have deep and subtle most knowledge in Ayurveda, Ayurvedic science, to explore any disease, infection or inflammation or autoimmunity or hypersensitivity or metabolic diseases or anything we can explore. So our science is medical science. Our science, by all means, Ayurvedic science is a medical science, because we are having medicine and we are having science. Medicine definition is something which is intended to reverse the disease and produce health. Science definition is the logics, clear-cut logics to explain cause, mechanism, effect, relationship, what is happening in the body in this kind of clinical condition, how you have to explore, what logic you have to apply here to understand, what logic you have to apply here to reverse, what medicine you are selecting here based on what logic. you are doing and how you are going to evaluate. What is your prediction regarding this particular decision which you have made in the case of the patient? Are you involving the patient in this? Are you involving the patient in this? Decision making, whether the patient is having any form of involvement in his recovery process, that is also to be explained here. So this is what is called science-based medicine. So Ayurveda is completely a science-based medicine. So this is what, first of all, I would like to know. I would like you to know. And also, evidence-based medicine, in modern medicine, before that, as I told you, they were practicing based on experiences and observations. And one morning, 1981, one day, David Sackett has decided, he himself, along with other people, he had decided that people should have some evidence, practitioners should have some evidence for their practice. And they started doing this kind of data-oriented research, biostatistics, implementing biostatistics and research methodology by means of which an unknown compound will be administered to population and they will be collecting data of benefits and risk in that limited population, in that limited period of time, and they will be outweighing benefits. They will be classifying, analyzing and evaluating benefits and risk. How much risk, how much benefit. According at that period of time, maybe later everything can change. If they extend the population to some more people, if they decide to study in variable populations, observations can vary because this data is merely based on observations. What they are finding in patients, unknown compound being given to patients, what observation they are getting from patients. That is what they consider as evidence. So it is evidence integrated medicine. And this is what they are practicing. So this point I want to know, I want you to know. And drug research agenda. So what happens is that there are many flaws for this kind of research. Sham diagnosis can happen. Short-term data, poor regularity, uncertainty, and many times statistically significant results need not be clinically significant. Why? Because it's not necessary that the patient in front of the physician may be exactly the same as the observation which you get in population. Population means many people observation, common observations you are taking, and all these observations you are compiling and you are classifying as benefits and risk. So how can you apply such a data of population to the exact patient? Suppose you are the patient, you are having your own unique cause circumstances. You cannot be compared to a population. Population means there are variable kinds of people who are undergoing various forms of diet, who are having variable forms of lifestyle, who are on variable medications, variable morbidities, comorbidities. But what is observed regarding one disease, the molecule action, whether suppression is happening in this case, how much suppression happening without risk. This analysis is much reductionist. Evidence to treat you. But this is what ultimately is considered to be evidence-based medicine today. So this is one main thing. And also this evidences can be manipulated by this drug manufacturer companies. Drug industry controls and funds all the research. So definitely every industry, as we know, they want to push the drugs. So they can manipulate in that. They can make benefit risk favorable way for them, and such drugs can get approved. Such possibilities are there. So, but in Ayurveda, it is another thing which I would like to tell. In Ayurveda, a medicine is to be decided by the science itself and not by the manufacturing company. So physician will be deciding medicine in accordance to the unique cause circumstances of the subject by applying science of Ayurveda. Science is our determinant. Science, we have logics. Why this? Is there medicine required in this case? If at all required, why you have chosen this medicine? What for this medicine? Why you are applying 2-3 medicines? If 3-4-5-6 medicines are applied, it is irrational prescribing. What I am telling is intended science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda. It's very unfortunate that what is being practiced for at least one century in Ayurveda is wrong. Unscientific practice, unscientific research, unscientific education, which is happening in Ayurveda. So this is what irrational Ayurveda, what is happening today. What is intended to happen is science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda. So we have been conducting, myself and my husband, Dr. Rajkumar, we have been conducting research from 2003. We were trying to understand the existing flaws in Ayurvedic practice, research and education, and we were able to develop science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda, where standardized decision-making methodology, golden standard of decision-making methodology for research and clinical practice were developed by us, which is called as evidence-triad approach. And we are giving training to doctors for the last 5 years, and they are also practicing the methodology. And now SBEBA practitioners know very well how their practice is different from conventional aimless practice of Ayurveda. So this is what, Essence Global organization might have observed are the results of practice of irrational prescriptions, irrational impact of irrational prescriptions and decision making. And most of such cases will be rushed to modern hospitals and end up in casualties or emergencies. So this is not the lacuna of the science as such. It is the lacuna of education. Our education is deeply flawed, and scientific practitioners are not emerging for this reason. So that is why this kind of irrational practice impact is observed in the society as Ayurveda practice. Now the second point is that too many drugs, like the second drawback of evidence-based medicine, so-called evidence-based medicine in modern medicine, too many drugs, because volume of evidences are there. So physicians cannot be sure which one to choose, and even though they teach a method called critical appraisal of literature, to choose which one is better evidence, which one is worse evidence. Even though it is happening, many people cannot be sure of how to choose medicine. So this can end up in irrational prescribing with multiple drugs. And also automated use of evidence through computerized decision support systems. This can happen. For example, a diabetes patient come. Computerized system will be giving information only regarding diabetes. But the patient is not diabetes. Patient is a patient with multiple complaints, and diabetes is just one complaint of the patient. And many of the things will be integrated. Sometimes patient might have used steroids, and after steroid usage, diabetes might have initiated, or something else might have triggered. One disease might have triggered another disease. Another one might be a complication, or irrational use of a medicine, or unscientific regimen and diet. These things are not considered at all. Just one medicine, one disease, one medicine. This is the approach. So if the people are having three diseases or four diseases, each and every disease will be the pathways, enzymes, etc., which deals with these diseases, which are involved in these diseases. They will be suppressed, blocked, or whatever it is. Sometimes it will be masking, blocking, suppressing, etc. will be done by different molecules, which are called as drugs. They call it as evidence-based drugs. Definitely, these drugs are proven to block, mask, suppress, etc. with less benefit and more risk in some period of time. But it is not sure whether you will get exactly benefits or risk in that point of period where you receive this drug. So this is the uncertainty which is prevailing. And what they are telling is falsifiability as a sign of research, proving wrong, is considered to be a sign of scientific research. So let me ask, the research is beginning with unknown compounds, and the research is progressing in uncertainty. How can there be, every time it will be falsifiable for sure, because there is no background. Suppose we, without learning theory, we are going to practical labs. We will be able to study any theorems or logics with confirmation? We will be never able to do so, no? Because we don't have any basement regarding which law, which theorem we are applying here, which logic we are experimenting, what is the procedure, etc. So when we are not knowing this, we are aimlessly considering some molecules which can block, mask, etc. And we are studying in three different phases. we are experimenting in healthy volunteers and unhealthy volunteers, and we are getting some benefits and risks. We are documenting the same, and we call it as evidence-based medicine. After 1 year, when this benefits are, sorry, risk are outweighing benefits, these drugs are discarded, and we call ourselves as we are updating or we are improving. So let me ask whether it is real improvement itself, because it is a journey from uncertainty to uncertainty and without any hopes for certainty. So I don't understand exactly why it is called as scientific research. And also, point number 4 is that multi-morbidity, one risk medicine may exacerbate the other. This is another point, as they are analyzing benefits and risk as the evidence of medicine. Evidence of medicine, what they consider is benefit outweighing risk. So one time for a one condition, for a patient in pain, some painkiller is prescribed. So that painkiller will may susceptibleness, those people who take painkillers are highly susceptible for gastrointestinal bleeding. So they are giving something to reduce the susceptibility for that, and antacids are being prescribed. So like that, if they are adding on compounds, considering that this may produce another risk for which another medicine is required, sometimes supplements will be given like that. So aimlessly, multiple drugs are being prescribed to the patient, and nobody knows how these multiple drugs, the impact of these multiple drug molecules, interact with each other inside the same body. All the drug molecules are reaching, going into the same system. So we don't know exactly what kind of cross interaction, nobody can study it perfectly, what kind of cross interaction can happen with different molecules aimed at different targets, working in different levels with multiple actions in the same body. So side effects means those effects, bad effects, which are expected to happen along with benefits inside the body by the physician, which are anticipated by the physician. Physician knows, even though you may not be asking the physician, or you may be asking the physician, physician may be telling or not, there are side effects for all the drugs in modern medicine. And what they are telling is that side effects happen because the drugs are working. So let me tell you, drugs, all drugs will work in some or other way, and they will produce some benefits. So they are intended to produce, if a drug is intended to produce benefits, definitely risk will be there. You know, when a drug is targeted to produce some benefits by blocking, masking, altering, suppressing enzymes, hormones, pathways, etc., how can you expect benefit alone? There will be definitely risk also by the side. That is what they call as side effects. Side effects may be, some may be known to the physician, some may be unknown to the physician, but definitely side effects are there. But this is not the case of Ayurveda. I will tell you why. Because in Ayurveda, there is nothing called blocking, masking, altering, suppressing, etc. We are advocated by our ancient scientists to reverse, to understand the cause mechanisms and reverse the same. Fast and without waiting time. That's what our scientists say. Without waiting time, don't watch and wait. Don't watch and wait. Do what is intended immediately and reverse the disease. Reverse the cause mechanisms of the disease. And we have medicines which are scientifically formulated by basic research. Our medicines are not unknown compounds. Our means medicines of Ayurveda, which are explained in Charaka, Susruta and Ashtanga Hridaya, are not unknown medicines. They are known in the sense they are developed by both basic and applied research, for which evidences are already explained in the texts. I am not blindly telling they are evidence-based medicines. Evidences are available in the texts. We can show you the evidences for what condition this medicine has to be used. Which part of, what kind of pathogenesis in that condition. It's not like therapeutic formulary. Okay, Ayurvedic texts are not like written like fever, these all medicines, cough, these all medicines, not like that. First, complete science of diagnosis and treatment principles are explained. After that, how to choose medicine is explained. Do you know that? How to choose medicine? In modern medicine, they are starting with unknown compounds. In Ayurveda, we are having science of how to choose medicine. It's not blocking, masking and suppressing. How to choose medicine to reverse the disease, to reverse the cause mechanisms. So what to know for that? For that, we should be knowing cause mechanisms of the disease, why this particular disease has happened in that patient, and how we can reverse, what logic we have to apply. And medicines are explored by these logics. There are scientific logics in Ayurveda to substantiate medicines. So these logics, for example, logic X, these medicines work by logic X, these medicines work by logic Y, these medicines work by logic Z. So we have to find out which logic is to be applied in this particular pathogenesis to reverse the cause mechanisms of the disease. So this is what is called drug medicine, scientific medicine in Ayurveda. All our medicines which are explained in Charaka, Susruta and Ashtanga Sangraha are science-based, evidence-based. They are not data-oriented science, data-oriented medicines. Data means, data in Ayurveda is meant to evaluate the intended results. Intended results. Out of 10 people, 2 people didn't get the intended effects in intended time. Then we have to go back into the science. It's not like you discard the medicine and invent new medicine. That is not the principle in Ayurveda. We have to go back to the science. We have to explore whether the diagnosis is correct, the logic behind the diagnosis is correct, whether the treatment logic is correct, whether the medicine you have selected is strictly based on that logic. So this is what is called research in Ayurveda. And this kind of research is not happening for the last 75 years for sure in Ayurveda. That is why Ayurveda community is becoming slaves to Western medicine. So even though we are having science-based, evidence-based medicine, we are not able to recognize and practice quality and purity of our science and medicine only because of flawed, extremely flawed education, research, and there are no clinical practice standards which are implemented in current Ayurveda practice by Ayurveda practitioners. So this is the reason why it is happening. So automated use of evidence, I have covered that, and multi-morbidity risk, and also this evidence-based medicine, what are the evidences in modern medicine? They consider 3 evidences: research evidence, clinical experience and patient values. So research evidence, I told you how they are collecting research evidence. Their research evidence has nothing to do with in the patient unique circumstances, nothing. They are evaluating population data, classifying, analyzing risk and benefit. And if they find that benefits outweigh risk, drug is approved for use. This is their research evidence. And clinical experience, obviously, there can be clinically experienced physicians. That depends on their basement knowledge in pathophysiology, diagnosis and everything, management. And patient values, something which is really... like you are asking, patient values means patients are involved in decision making. Doctor is asking the patient whether you want knee replacement surgery or you want painkillers. So patient can decide, knee replacement surgery costs this much and painkillers only this much. So which one you will opt for? Anyway, painkillers are meant only for pain killing and not to reverse the joint destruction or inflammation. So if a patient is prescribed NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs also, the doctor is sure that there will be a certain point where NSAIDs cannot be prescribed anymore and the patient will end up in joint replacement surgery itself. But simply patients are asked which one is better for you. How will a patient know? How will an ordinary person know which one is better? So he will tell naturally what you opt for. We will choose. What doctor, what you think is better for me, I will choose that. That will be the ultimate thing what patients are telling. I mean, majority of patients are telling. But this is not something which is mentioned in Ayurveda. In Ayurveda, what is explained is, you have to involve the patient in his recovery. You have to involve the patient. Because only if you are able to pinpointedly understand the flaws in the diet and regimen of the patient, how and why this cause mechanisms of disease were got initiated inside the patient. It is definitely by his own erroneous diet and regimen. Maybe for one day or 1 week or 1 month or 1 year, can vary from person to person depending on his immune status, metabolic status, circulatory status, drainage status, etc. It can vary, but definitely it is with respect to his own diet and regimen and his lifestyle. So you have to explore it correctly and you have to educate the patient what he can do to reverse the disease quickly. For us, for example, a patient who is having infection or inflammation, we are educating. We mean science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda practitioners are educating the patient. You are prone to increase inflammation if you use this kind of diet, this kind of regimen. How and why this kind of diet? You may be wondering. Again, you are, what is the proof that this diet will increase? Let me tell you, there are very scientific, logical proofs. We are having logical proofs for everything. We are not having some data to substantiate more benefit and less risk. We are having logical, rational proofs. Why? How? All these things are explained by our logics. Why this patient, if takes sore things, how his pain will increase within moments, within minutes, how his pain will increase. And if he does the opposite thing, how his pain will decrease. We can show also. These logics do not exist in text as some abstract ones. It can be demonstrated in every person, healthy and unhealthy, depending on the condition. So this is what makes a medical science a science. This is what exactly a medical science is intended to be. A medical science is intended to explore the patient. A medical science begins with the patient. A medical science comprehends the patient. And a medical science involves the patient in his own recovery process and reverse the disease. So with scientific Ayurveda, science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda, it is possible to take the patient out of medicine and disease. That is the scientificity. The best proof of scientificity of a medicine is that, or a medical science is that, with scientific employment of principles or logics of Ayurveda, it is possible to take the patient out of medicine and disease. Whereas in modern medicine, most of the lifestyle diseases, they are asking not to stop medicine. In autoimmune diseases, not to stop medicine. So when medicine is not stopped, medicine is intended just to block or mask or suppress, then what is the logic of calling it as a medicine? It is just modern adjustment drug therapy. I would call it MAT therapy, modern adjustment drug therapy. So in emergencies, there are no medicines like, it is just a life-saving mechanism. That is fine. For life-saving mechanisms, it is fine. Like accident happens, trauma happens, or when a person collapses and it is not possible to give, patient is not responding to anything. So in such cases, something can be done. Anything can be done. So that apart from that, people are having diseases, several diseases. Nowadays, diseases means all the people above 30 are having some or other drugs they are taking. And above 50 means more number of drugs. Above 70 means they are carrying big, kids with medicines. So this is the condition. And they are constantly having one or another problems, always. And sometimes they are collapsing also. Sometimes a sudden death is also happening. So this is the condition. So it is not a sign of, it is not an evidence of scientificity of medicine. This kind of evidence-based medicine is not a sign of scientificity of medicine. So let me conclude what an evidence-based medicine is intended to be. And this is exactly what science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda is doing. First point is that ethical cure and care of the patient at its topmost priority. A scientific medicine is intended to promote ethical or produce ethical cure and care of the patient. It's not to do some adjustment with benefit risk outweighing. Sometimes some other point of time in the same patient, benefits may turn out to be risk. So it should not be like that. There is no ethics in such kind of treatment, in my personal opinion. So ethical care and cure means you are doing something to reverse the cause mechanisms of the disease. That is what is ultimately ethical cure is intended to be, or ethical care is intended to be. And second, demands individualized circumstance analyzing logic intended evidence in a format that clinicians and patients can understand. There should be logics, should not be based on number in data. There should be logics based on individualized cause circumstances. Every patient cause circumstances should be analyzed by logics. He can have multiple diseases. So a scientific practitioner of Ayurveda is not intended to prescribe four different medicines for four different diseases in the same subject. That is the scientificity of Ayurveda. Another evidence for scientificity of Ayurveda. So Ayurveda is such a science where the logic enables the practitioner to integrate multiple pathologies in the same subject at the same time and avoid interdepartmental transfer. So there is no reason to go to different departments, different medical departments of Ayurveda and seek treatment. Yes, a very good quality scientific medical practitioner can reverse multiple pathologies with pinches of medicines. Pinches of one medicine, classical medicine, one or two medicines, medicated water for a definite period and reverse the disease. And it is amazingly fast. And in the case of acute diseases, it is very fast and it doesn't require any hospital admission for Panchakarma and other treatments. In fact, Panchakarma and all are required only for less than 5% diseases in the whole world, all kinds of diseases. Less than 5% cases only require Panchakarma. Nowadays, reverse is happening. 95% cases are irrationally managed by Panchakarma and aimless medications. We know that Ayurveda prescriptions are loaded with medicines. This is not the approach and attitude of science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda. So what you find around us Ayurveda, don't make judgment based on what you observe around us Ayurveda. It is not science-based, evidence-based. So if you want to observe those who blame that Ayurveda is not scientific, if you want to see the impact of scientific prescribing, you please, I welcome you to science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda practitioners. You observe them, what they are doing. You observe the impact of their prescriptions in the patients. And later only you make judgment about Ayurveda. Okay. And third point, involve all the aspects of the patient rather than one disease. This I have covered. Shares decisions with patients, with meaningful conversations with patients. It's not like you take the medicine, okay, don't skip the dosage, okay, don't skip even a single dosage, okay, and doctor, is there any side effect? No, side effects are all less compared to benefits. You will be benefited. You don't skip. This can only be told by modern medicine. Why? Because they are doing suppression, blocking, masking, etc. So even skipping a single dosage can cause problems. So they don't need to consider diet, lifestyle, etc., etc. Maybe some quality practitioners will be telling them to exercise or whatever is required. But apart from that, they need to consider only drugs. This is not the responsibility of a scientific practitioner of Ayurveda. He has to explain every minute, most aspects in the diet and regimen of the patient. He is taking ultimate responsibility of the patient. It's not like prescribing and leaving the patient. Scientific Ayurveda practitioners are taking complete responsibility of the patient till their recovery. So it is a bit higher responsibility than modern medicine practitioners. So this is what sharing decisions with patients. What I am going to do in my patient, I have to explain. I have to explain in such a way comprehensive to him. I have to make him do that. I have to ensure that he is doing. I have to follow up systematically and I have to evaluate the response of what I am doing, and with the results he will be encouraged to cooperate with me very much. Once he knows that within one day pain is subsiding, within one day he is getting active, energetic, definitely the patients are getting encouraged to follow scientific Ayurveda guidelines without much medicines, easy to adopt, without disturbing routine. So this is the sign of scientificity of Ayurveda, let me tell you. So this is what I'm doing. Don't think that what I'm telling is story. This is what I'm doing right from 2003. And now it is 2021. I completed my MD in 2003. And from that period onwards, I told you, we have done basic and applied research. And we have publications and we have trained other practitioners also in this methodology. And how to choose what to do instead of what to choose to mask, block, etc. This is one another thing in comparison to modern medicine. What scientific Ayurveda practitioners are doing is deciding how to choose what to do. How to choose what to do is not explained by pharma companies. How to choose what to do is explained by our science. We have to go deep into our science, our logics. We have to see the patients. We have to translate the logics into the patients. We have to analyze. That's what critical appraisal for us. We are not supposed to sit in front of computer and check PubMed evidences of data. We are supposed to go deep into our samhitas to understand the logics and understand the patient by applying the logics. This is not happening in professional Ayurveda education. So professional Ayurveda education is to emerge in such a way to translate these science-based evidences, primary evidences which are available in samhitas, how to translate them in newly emerging diseases. This is already done by science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda. Only thing, it has to be incorporated. This curriculum, BAMS MD curriculum, is to be oriented on science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda. So this is what is important. And science of healing must choose medicine instead of data of drugs with manufacturers. So science of healing, Ayurveda is science of healing. Ayurveda is not science of benefit risk. Ayurveda is science of healing. So we have, our motto is not do no harm. The motto of modern medicine is do no harm. But they cannot guarantee that. But our motto is do the intended. Do the intended on time. Our ancient scientists are telling, do not waste time. Do the intended on time. In the first stage itself, reverse the disease. This is what our scientists are telling. So our responsibility is far above their responsibility. And we have a science to guide us to do what is intended also. So transparent and reproducible logics. These are the last point which I have written. So scientificity is determined by originally, not by biostatistical methods. It is innately present inside the science, which is determined by transparency and reproducibility. So what is transparency? Transparency means the logics inside the science should be open to all. There is a misled notion that Ayurveda is some Divya Aushadha or something which is divine like that. It's not like that. We are having a definite science which explains logics. You know, how to choose logics, how to understand logics. This is what is called transparency. And any person who is learning BAMS, who is qualified in BAMS, is supposed to learn and understand this. Nowadays, it's not happening. It is the failure of Ayurveda education. But any person who is learning Ayurveda must understand the logics too and must also know how to translate these logics. It is completely transparent. When I'm treating a patient, I can document these logical evidences. Based on this logic, I have diagnosed, and based on this logic, I have chosen this medicine, and by this cause mechanism effect got reversed by this logic administration. So this is what is called evidence-based reports, case reports in Ayurveda. It's not like statistical graphs and benefit-risk ratio analysis. Nowadays, peer review journals are stupid in Ayurveda because there are no peers. All are doing this blind, stupid biostatistical research. Even this biostatistical research means it is meant for modern medicine because they don't have anything else to prove the effectiveness and safety of the drugs. That is why they are adopting it. Why should we follow them despite of us having all these things? We are neglecting them because of complexity and subtlety. We cannot take time to understand, and nobody is trying to understand also. And we are claiming that we are having lacunae, we are not having evidence. Let me tell you, Ayurveda community itself is responsible for other outside people to think that Ayurveda is unscientific, because you are not trying to understand the scientificity and apply the scientificity of your own medical system. So people outside, naturally they are suffering. You are not able to rationally prescribe. You are not able to rationally explain. You are not able to confidently tell also that you can reverse this infection or inflammation. So if you fail to do that, naturally people outside will ask you many things, and you will be telling some scientific Sanskrit terminologies which they think is absurd. That is because they are like, they don't know anything. So it is like, you know, people will feel uncomfortable when they hear something which is unconventional. That is quite not natural. So this is what is happening, and reproducible. Anyone who is learning logic can apply it scientifically and get scientific results, intended results. So this is what is called evidence-based Ayurveda. And evidence-based Ayurveda is science-based. We have two evidences, primary and secondary evidences. And we are a medical science. Ayurveda is a medical science by all means. Because we choose medicine by science, we apply medicine by science, and we end up in confirmatory established observations. We cannot say that we know everything, but we are in the right path. Our journey is not from uncertainty to uncertainty. That is for sure. Why? Because we are having theorems. We don't have any theories in our science. We have only theorems. Theorems, the definition is Parikshagir Bahuvidam Pariksha Heduvir Sadhaitva Stapide Nirnayaha. Theorems or Siddhantas are that results or outcome of basic and applied research which are being experimented by multiple scientists in multiple period, in multiple ways. Heduvir Sadhaitva, substantiated by cause-effect relationship and established. So this is what is called theorems. We don't have any theories. Ayurveda is a deterministic science, not a probabilistic one. So because of these differences, it is absolutely, absolutely absurd to interpret Ayurveda in terms of Western science methodologies of research. So once we are adopting our own research methodologies, clinical methodologies, we can easily substantiate, we can easily expose the innate scientificity and potential of Ayurveda. This talk is being done just to inform the public, because these days so many absurd comments and ridiculous remarks are made by people outside regarding Ayurveda by their utter ignorance. Let me tell you, friends, you have no right to comment on Ayurveda because you don't know Ayurveda. If you want to know Ayurveda, approach science-based, evidence-based Ayurveda practitioners. They will tell you in a sensible way to you. Even without you being an Ayurveda practitioner also, we will try to make you understand, and you can lively observe also in the matter of patients how they are recovering in a very short period with very negligible medicines. Okay, so you are always welcome, and the counter arguments for this are also welcome, but no personalized abuse is welcome. Thank you. Good.